we're going to be using this Slido app pretty extensively. So if you've got it up already, that's good. If you haven't, it's sli.do, and the magic number is 4938. And you might need that thread. 49 is 7 squared, and then you take one off each number to make 38. It's an easy way to remember.
You wrote that on the chart, we don't see that.
It's a sweet number. It is a sweet number. It's probably
because it's 4 to 3 and 9 to 8.
Yeah. So,
now,
can you put 4 to 3? 4938 on there.
Sometimes it locks you out and messes you about.
So it does.
And what we're going to do is we're going to give you a chance to vote up, like thumbs up or thumbs down, once you get in there. It's on the general overall questions. Okay, so right at the top, Martin's put in a load of questions. So if you go to EASG 17 overall and go to questions, you will see a load of questions there. And what I'd like you to do, please, is go through those questions and say, yeah, that's a good one. I wouldn't mind that being answered. Put a thumbs up. Or no, that's a load of rubbish. Thumbs down. Or don't really care. Which case, leave them alone. Okay, so just 5 minutes just to look through the questions and see which ones you want us to answer. What we'll do is that will give us some priority in terms of answering it. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much. Is that clear? Any questions? No, that's good.
Sorry, I'm on the main page. Where is this question for? This is a mobile.
It's on EASG 17 overall.
Questions.
Yeah, the very top section. I'll drop down a list of sections, very top one.
Any questions? Yeah.
And then there's a tab left for questions.
Ooh, it's coming already.
Keeps changing.
Yeah, racking it up. No tactical voting, please. If your neighbour voted for one, don't counter vote, please.
And there's a question up there that you'd like to answer. Feel free to volunteer.
Yeah, you can add your own question if you want.
Ah, no directionality in the stars. It just says, five blanks, it says give you all great, it doesn't say which is one, which is five. Which is that, which is me?
Yes. It's five stars higher than yes.
Well, Lorne, as you can see, it's might be a long tail, but it's a favourite.
Yeah.
These are being ranked dynamically.
Oh, the technology is awesome.
Of course, the really embarrassing thing is if there's a really good question, we have no answers.
Left-hand side, the thing doesn't work.
It's not as clear as this. It's not as clear as that. No, it's not Slido. It's not the jet tab.
Is that out of focus?
No, it's one of the... The other half thing gets done.
However, I mean, what I am displaying on my screen is simply the admin view of what's on your handset. If anybody's stuck, I have a tablet here I can loan you.
Yes, thank you.
Do you have another one? Anybody got a chain and a padlock so I can fasten it to the chair? anybody else is stuck, you can borrow my mobile, but you'll have to answer any calls. And say, this is the Tate residence, Butler speaking. That's just part of the deal. And talking of tactical voting, you can't vote 20 times for the same thing. I don't know if you tried it, but if you tap one you've already given a thumbs up to, it says, do you want to
withdraw the word? I did it by accident.
Yeah. Yeah, it's quite clever.
Well, I've got 20.
You've got 20. Have you got 20 handsets? Actually, if you have 20 handsets, you deserve 20 votes because you're quite clearly a man of some substance.
All right, one more minute and then we'll.
That'd be substance abuse.
Could be. Yeah, it's a fair point, Tom. I don't know what he's on, but it's good and I want some. I don't know about you.
Can you shut the thing off when we...
I can turn off voting, yes.
Turn off voting.
Yeah.
Right, turning off voting in 30 seconds.
I didn't have to reply to it.
Such control. Probably on Sally's thing, I'd be very red.
I think, can you do it?
Yeah. All right, 10 seconds.
What I'm actually going to do is I'm going to turn on moderation so they appear on my screen and I can make them live.
Oh, great.
It's a really
fantastic
good question.
Okay.
And for instance, can I buy you a beer, Martin? Would probably go across. Okay, countdown on.
All right, let's stop the voting then. Ding dong, ding dong. Right, so the first one. Can you read it out, Martin?
Yeah, okay.
See it.
How can the often archaic EA discipline / profession become as agile as the business needs to be to succeed in the disruptive digital economy? This was originally asked in the 10:30 keynote from Christine, but I pulled that across because I thought it was an interesting question and obviously it's attracted the eye.
So Christine, why don't you start with you?
Oh my goodness.
There you go. Give your view on it. From your session.
So I think play it back a bit. So it's about how will these IT departments become digitally agile. So I think one of the themes that has gone on today is about being perhaps a bit clear about the things that we focus on and the things that we've done. And I thought there was an interesting talk this afternoon about making relationships between roadmaps and focusing perhaps things on the things that were missing and the things that made the relationships rather than perhaps focusing on everything that already exists. So maybe one of the things we've got to do is to find a way to maybe abstract ourselves from, let's just call it the current landscape, and try and be a bit more discerning in terms of the things that we really focus on. And actually really ask ourselves the question why those things have suddenly become important. I think it's tricky. I think it is quite tricky, actually. I think that's the next meeting, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't know if you asked it, but it's a good question. Any other thoughts then on this? How we can succeed? Yeah, right at the back. Sorry, I've only got one mic. I'm trying to see if we can get another one.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Sean Mandalani. I'm a professor in business school, so I'd like to share maybe two responses to that. One from my professor role, one from a European CIO role that I did previously. So if I take the European CIO role, I would say that the only way you can truly be agile in that respect is by piloting. So it's engaging with the CEO on that level, finding out what they need to do, and then making it work as a pilot. Because ultimately, you're transforming your organization. You're not going to be able to do it quickly. What you can do is demonstrate that that new operating model can work, and you can pilot it. So that is my experience there. The counter-argument, which is based on some research we've been doing with McKinsey, is don't try and do it. Because actually, it's the wrong thing to do. Because the research finds that when you are doing this agility stuff and just doing things, be agile, you keep it divorced from your legacy stuff and you keep it separate. Yes, you provide something quicker, but what you end up doing is adding complexity. So in fact, you make your longer term review of architecture much more complex. So maybe two different arguments, maybe you can put them together, maybe you can't.
Which one do you believe?
Thanks, Morten. Actually, I like the connection with other disciplines, and it just came to me the manufacturing process of Japanese sword, or samurai sword. It is cooled differentially. The rod of steel, after being hammered several times, is cooled with varying thickness of mud. So the bit that has the thicker mud cools slower, and the bit that has the thinner mud cools faster. So you have flexibility at the top of the sword, and stability and rigidity at the bottom of the sword. The question is, do you need to be equally agile in all costs? Do you need to be completely and fully agile? I would argue not. We need to be more agile than others. And the trick is making your decision correctly about which parts need to be more stable or relatively less agile than others, so that you have the flexibility where you need it, not all over the place. It's about the complexity differential. Differentially agile, be differentially agile.
What a beautiful metaphor. That deserves a round of applause. I love metaphors. Fantastic, thank you. Any other thoughts? Come on, Dal, you must have a thought.
I didn't volunteer because you read my thoughts. Okay. So, agility is merely a tool or device for delivering value. And it relies on the idea of feedback and recognition that I have to change something and I have to change it now. Okay. So, at the top level, the clear ideas of the value we're seeking become a tool for understanding when we need to change quickly, when we need to be agile and not. Being agile in itself is nothing. If you do agility so that you produce more value more quickly, then you must be doing agile right, whatever you're doing.
Thank you. Any other thoughts? Christine, back to you.
Years ago, I worked in a building that was over in Manchester. It was quite an interesting building. And we used it as a massive data center. And it was okay. It had good loading bays and all the rest of it. But what I hadn't appreciated was when the architects built this building, they built it so that it would be valuable to whoever owned it in terms of the different things they could use it for. So they built this building so that it could be a municipal center, it could be a shopping mall, and it could be used as offices and data centers. Now, the point of that is that as soon as somebody told you that and you looked around it, you just sort of thought, so that's why that comes there, or that balcony is there. But I suppose the point is that they architected enough for it to have value for like a data center, but they didn't over-architect it so that it couldn't be a shopping center, right? So I suppose there's something about how do we know when we've done enough architecture on the various things in our landscape that mean that, we've done enough, we've added enough value, but there's enough value still there to build up Tom's point, so that when we want to come back, we can rapidly add more value.
I think that's another really good metaphor. Thank you. Come on, a round of applause for Christian. It's like this room. We've been pretty cool at using these rooms in that sort of way as well today. I mean, it's been great, this facility, where being able to collapse rooms and add them back again, depending on what's needed. So these metaphors are very powerful and important. I still think the samurai swords are great.
Yeah, that
and mud. I don't know what the mud is in here, but any other thoughts on this question? Otherwise, we'll move to the next one. Yeah, Tom.
I was just picking up on the comment about the often archaic EA profession. Do we see ourselves as archaic? What do we see as archaic? What doesn't work? It's an interesting question to explore. I'm not going to make any comment on it. But it was just that one about okay.
Perhaps you're getting old.
I know.
No, it is a good point. There's a hidden other question in there around the archaic, like archaeology. Any quick thoughts on that?
We talk about artifacts.
Go on, Sally.
When I worked at British Airways, we were not allowed to use the word. We used the word artifacts a lot, but we were told off for doing it, and everybody did because it was seen as very hostile. And I don't really see why, because I'm an archaeologist of artifacts, but clearly you have to recognise that some words just turn people off. So if you find one of those, you've got to find a different way of describing it. But that, the use of the word artifact probably leads to the archaic image.
I have to get you to answer that one, Mr. Otter.
I think at the end of the day, it depends on the definition of enterprise architecture. So when we talk about artifacts, we're really talking about products. I don't want to comment on British Airways because their systems recently crashed. So, but no, let's move on to the next question.
Okay.
Awesome.
Fantastic. Well, that's the first question. That got 14 points. So the next one is with Agile. Can we get that one on the screen?
Yeah.
And then maybe you could kindly read it out for us.
With Agile development driving down the level of software documentation, how does this interface with the business requirement and architectural elements such that software as an engineering methodology is maintained? Question from Martin Mills, who I believe should win our prize for the most upvoted question. The first one was anonymous.
Oh, okay. Good. Well done, Martin. We're not giving prizes away. Tom, you must be able to answer this one.
Well, if I understood it, I would. I'm trying to get this bit about software as an engineering methodology. I'm not sure what the software is. I mean, do we mean a software engineering methodology? Yeah, okay, let's assume that.
Is Martin in the room?
This comes from one of the earlier talks. This is about treating software as an engineering skill set as opposed to just writing random software.
It's treating software as a discipline.
Yes.
Rather than an engineer thing.
Yes.
Okay, fine. I'm very much against Agile getting rid of all documentation and possible going to code. That's number one. I think there are certain minimum things, like it might be nice to have quantified the values that the whole project was trying to get to, as opposed to ignoring them totally and failing 40% of the time, right? So there's a mess out there, and the mess is, the measure of the mess is the degree of failure to projects under Agile, right? Okay, let's see. I think I'll just limit myself there.
Yeah, I think it's never about completely doing away with documentation. Again, running it down, but just at the minimum, what is needed. So you have to document what is needed. So I'll say things like the architecture of the requirements, the basic requirements that have to be there, whatever operations you go into, is really very important, because this becomes like a main argument when things go haywire and you have conflict of resources, for example, and debate amongst people. So you have to have this kind of shared artifact in terms of minimum, but essential documentation that you have to refer to. So it's a question of balance, really.
I think I'd just argue that I see documentation having two purposes. One is, I think what you're saying, which is about governance in the creation of a new system. But for me, it's also about understanding someone else's system. And that's often where I get frustrated, is that I have a system I need to maintain, a system that I need to take forwards, and I have no idea how it works, and I'm not left any documentation about why this is done and where it was. I'd love some more. Yeah, well, in code, you can spend days looking through code to understand the really cute bit of logic that someone put in to reduce their code from a page to three lines. Mm. And that's not worth spending time for.
It's
really just a recommendation. If you're concerned about this, do look at the work of Simon Brown on software. If you'll find him on Twitter as Simon Brown. And he's done some very good work on software architecture and documentation for software architecture. Do have a look at his work. He's got a very nice way of embedding it in the code as well. So Simon Brown.
I'm thinking that we may need a bibliography or something for today. There's some great references.
Yeah. Yes. Fine. I guess my thought was around where do you tend to find agile development? It tends to be in like your systems of innovation as opposed to your systems of record. I talked to someone earlier about bimodal IT, etc., or two speed. And so I guess the point is like if you've got like you've architected the change, you've got that well-defined set of APIs being presented. The guys who are doing whatever they want to do in that sort of system of innovation space, well, hey, they can do whatever. But as long as, from an enterprise architecture, we're sort of like presenting the well-defined service layer, which they can then, which represent the capabilities and how we wish to present those. That may be a bit of a SOA-esque sort of answer to the question, but. That's kind of like one of the ways which I sort of approached the problem of like not having a sight of any documentation or architecture within that system of innovation space, because the length, those systems of innovation don't tend to live that long.
Great, thank you. Any other thoughts, particularly from the author, Martin? Okay. Yeah, useful discussion. I think the systems of innovation versus the systems of record stuff is interesting. There may well be that's where you put more or less mud on to your skin, something like that. Good. All right. So the next one then.
What would you recommend as a starting point in setting up a QA function in an organisation? You recently embarked on this journey, and without much guidance on how to approach capability mapping, we've started with the VMOST analysis of the organisation. Would you recommend this as a sensible start? Question from Corlia Bell.
Is Corlia in the room? Do you want to expand on this, or maybe a bit?
I think that probably sums it up. We want to start with that journey.
I think that question sums it up. For me, I don't know if it's true to anybody else. We were at the start of that journey and we're still pointing our way through this, so I'm curious to know whether that's a sensible approach.
Okay.
Dal, to answer that. So, several years ago, I set up an architecture practice for my secure government department. For me, the first thing, the starting point, was not the terms of reference or any of that kind of stuff, it was shame and value. Because when someone's investing into a capability, I don't know how many architects you have, but the key thing for they want is to show the value. So what I did, I produced a level zero of the organization, and I used that level zero to go through the organization to sell the EA practice. And when I received the funding, that's what we moved down to products. But I think the starting point should be the level zero. What is it actually? So if you go through the stack, you should be able to kind of highlight it. I'll give you some demos. I wrote a chapter in the book which was all about this, which if you send me an email, I'll send it to you.
Any other thoughts? Okay,
I suppose I'll talk from my own experience of stuff on in process really. I've been doing it for a year now, about seven at EA practice. I think for me, one of the first things is actually really demonstrating where EA applies itself in the organisation and making that really clear to my key stakeholders, say, where do I operate, how do I operate, and looking at it from that perspective. So it's sort of meaningful for them. Could be the cheapest actually use Codap as my framework, but I think what I found with it though is you actually have to go back and read it. So don't just take your training and go, oh, I know it all. To go and actually read what it says hoping is take it slowly and implement bits that we need at the time, not stakeholders really, but to the run. The other stuff will come along over time.
So just make sure you're constantly chatting about it.
I think it's a bit more fundamental than that, because the company I worked for had a complete organisation change in the way that they do design strategy, the whole essence of the design frameworks, and also the training of people as well. So they invested in the training of people, then they created the enterprise architect to actually manage that and manage that through internal suppliers, external and stuff like that. That's where I think that's where starting in practice is the organisation that has to change to accept that. And the fundamental bits that we did is actually changing the way that we do designs, the documentation. We had a system integration architecture to put, which was fundamental to the actual setting up of the enterprise architecture and the people running that. That's any suggestion to you.
Great. Also, thinking on this, it's useful to pluck out as well which areas you might want to engage with in a business.
I guess my thoughts would be, from my experience, is find somewhere to save some money with it. That would be, and give yourself some breathing space, give yourself a year, give yourself some time, find something like this. That would be my, it won't be the big strategic thing, it won't be the business architecture, it won't be the data, it would be some technology. Project you can kill, or something that will save some money, and that's my experience, is make something obvious, make further slack, which happens this year, and then you've got time.
So go and make friends with the finance guys, find out what it costs on.
Yeah.
I'll give three examples. One of them's an anti-pattern. Do not rush out to buy a shiny new tool. I've seen that happen too many times. They haven't got a clue what they're doing with it. You often train up only one person, and she leaves, you know, nice shelf life. We had one large organisation in Australia where we tried to do exactly yours, and we hit against a lucky problem, which was that all the big IT systems, six of them were listed as line items, and everything else was listed as other. But the cost of every project would show up. So that by definition, every project to shut something down had a negative business case. So we were screwed. We couldn't do a thing. Millions upon millions of dollars wasted every year for things that didn't even exist 30 years ago that we were still paying for. But the one good one, this was in Australia Post. One thing we set out to do was get building models, which we call functional business models. We knew it had value, but every single manager nicked a copy and put it on their wall and used it for everything else, like onboarding, because it was the first time they had a view of the organisation as a whole. That kind of model taken down, certainly if you get to three tier, that's that will really be. One tier is universal, the first tier is universal for every organisation. Second tier is pretty much the same for every organisation in your industry. Third tier is when you start seeing who you are. Limited to a maximum of 250 capabilities, which means you have a lovely fight with every different silo, because they don't want to put every one of their capabilities in. You know, you're going to constrain it. But if you do that, the window between 250 and 300 capabilities, it'll fit on an A4 to A3 sheet, and every manager will make a copy and use it as a standard reference. So it's a really valuable little tool. Yeah? You can do it in Visio or anything. So that's our experience.
Thanks, Tom. Any other thoughts?
Yeah. Just a really quick practical example. Go talk to the CFO, CEO, and ask what keeps them in mind.
Yep.
Simple. So cool.
Back to you, Corbin. Hang on. Just give us a few as to what you've learned.
That was all very useful. Thank you very much for that. Just on the point of those models are one and the same. I think the approach we took with using Vivo is trying to figure out what are the business capabilities, what are the things that
going back to the strategy, going back to the business vision, what is the thing they're trying to achieve? We looked at different models and actually found there's quite a few different ones, even at level 1, 2, and 3, quite different models out there. I think we used Gartner quite extensively for ideas and stuff. And in the end, got to the point where, okay, we're going to have to just start from scratch, to start with our own organization and just try and mold that with the basics. We look at, yes, what is it that's the highest objective in the strategy, and see if we can make an impact on that. That's what we think we're going down. Just want to find out whether that is a good approach or not.
I think his approach is better than one about find a quick hit to establish that, hey, we're actually here to solve real business issues. But if that one won't play, which it didn't in this case, then the capability ones start to become useful. But you know you've achieved value when people start thinking you're worth it. That's a really useful cue.
Okay, great. Thank you for that question. And we're on to the next one.
Question is, on balance, do your key stakeholders think enterprise architecture makes a valuable contribution to their digital transformation?
Well, I think we'll have a show of hands here. How many people think that their key stakeholders think that EA makes a valuable contribution to their digital transformation? Hands up.
Half.
Okay. That's not,
put it
away. Yeah,
15. What's 15%. The
corollary? Hands up if you think, on balance, your key stakeholders do not think that EA makes a valuable contribution. A couple of people. Hands up if you didn't put your hand up. Most people don't know.
I think the main issue there is that they just don't understand.
Certainly where I come from consultancy background, going into various times, if you say to them, what's your plan for digitization of your environment and how can enterprise architecture help? Sorry, what? What does that mean? What is EA? What is digital? And frankly, I don't really understand my business that much anyway. So help me understand my business. Help me understand what IT does as an enabler, and help me understand how EA can get that to go forward. But I don't put my hand up either, because I just think that we have a real issue about telling our senior stakeholders what is enterprise architecture. Because we don't know really ourselves in many ways.
Is Richard Barton here?
Hello.
Richard, you framed this question. What was the context?
Well, I ran a session this afternoon that was exploring some challenges and some ideas about how to apply EA in these kind of environments. So I was just interested in whether I was alone in seeing some issues in this area, or whether it was a general problem everyone experienced. I'm guessing it's kind of half and half.
Yeah.
Just one thing I'd say is, I think actually it's not necessarily that I think enterprise architecture is a valuable contribution. I think we've really got to look personally at ourselves and say, actually, do I think us as an enterprise architect make a valuable contribution? I think EA for me is as much about the person or the people as it is about the function. I think we have to demonstrate our ability to help.
Christine, this is kind of in line with the talk you did as well, the keynote.
So I suppose one part of me thinks, well, why should we expect them to understand that enterprise architecture would be involved anyway? So actually, should we really be focusing on the end results and, you know, just provide an absolute clarity? Because, you know, one of the things that keeps going on in businesses, they do get very frustrated that they can't go as fast as they would like, irrespective of whether that's right or wrong. And then almost like the reaction is to lash out and go hire a CDO or something. I've got many, too many CDOs in the world. And almost like, right, we've hired a CDO now, we'll sort it out. And I just wonder whether, if we continue to focus on outcomes and some of the advice we were talking about earlier about picking some spots that we know is a business weakness or we know is a business frustration, that we say, look, you know, as a team we all got together and sorted this out, rather than just really splitting enterprise architecture off. And maybe what we're really saying is, well, actually, in a world of cloud and as a service, how does the IT or the information department, call it what we will, reposition itself for success in this climate? And how does it as a whole start to add value? Maybe a bit of a question to ask.
That's interesting. I've been doing some work with a client recently where I've not hunted for problems, but I've used a thing called appreciative inquiry. It's quite an old thing, where you're actually hunting for really good things in a business that you can build on. And it's really interesting the flip you get with clients, because they start to both value the most valuable bits of the business and get very creative about how they can change their business model to build on their strengths rather than chase down their weaknesses. So I think someone mentioned it earlier, you know, the opportunities and the risks, or the opportunities and the downside of the business need to be balanced. But if you go hunting for good stuff and then build on that, then obviously you can also create a better yearly function because you're actually creating more value on something that's already valuable, if that makes sense. Any other thoughts on that question? Good question. Yes, Sean.
I think it's a brilliant question, I have to say. And I have these, those of you who attended the Stop and Main presentation will see that one of the questions, what's the most valuable skill that's required? And 60% said vision, strategy, roadmap development, and 10% said stakeholder engagement. I think the reality is you can't do vision, strategy, roadmap development if you don't have stakeholder engagement. And therefore, without that, you can't make it happen. And the survey that we did with McKinsey said 40% of organizations, they just weren't aware of what enterprise architecture does at all. So I think the absolute key thing for me is what I call the virtuous circle of engagement and credibility that you need to build with your stakeholders. And the more engaging you are, the more credible you are, the more engaging you are. And the other way is also true.
We still need you to come and present that McKinsey stuff to us one evening. You said you might be able to. Yeah, good. Thanks. Any other thoughts on that? Otherwise, we'll move to the next question.
Yes, yeah. Thank you. Goldratt's theory of constraints.
Oh, yes.
Yes. And his point is exactly the opposite to the one you're making, which is to find the weakest point and build on those to get the best return.
Yeah, that may be true, but I think the answer is both, you know?
Yeah.
Go back to Sean sort of sitting on the fence.
Yeah.
But all I'm saying is that if you go down and hunt the good stuff, it's a very powerful way to build on value. We're all trying to create value, as opposed to be a policeman. I've seen EA factions collapse because they basically become corporate policemen and everybody hates them. It's a balance. Anyway, any other thoughts? No? Yes, one.
That's a good question.
So if the EA function has a philosophy of gardening, if you will, then find something which is flourishing, particularly if they need to take cuttings from it, is the is to sort of put a different slant on the point made about focusing on your strengths. So as well as that, you could take a weeding function and get rid of things which are sapping resources in that organisation. But as well, through events such as this, bring new species or seeds to experiment and scatter in the gardens and see what springs up.
Fantastic. Another fantastic metaphor. A round of applause. Excellent. Any more metaphors? I really love it. No? Okay. On to the next question then. I think it's for Tom.
No. Actually, Norman, you may take a view as to whether we've covered this. It's very much the theme of the conference. The question is EA relevant in the modern economy? How can you keep it current when you need to be agile? Nimble organization. think most of those themes would probably be covered, but there might be more comments.
Yeah, so the title of today is Making EA Relevant. So let's focus on that, because that's actually key to the whole conference. How many people here feel after today that EA is a bit more relevant to them than it was at the beginning of the day? I hope so. Any thoughts on relevance? Because, I mean, this is quite important. Yeah.
I guess sort of we talk about lots of agile, small changes going on in organisations. Maybe big organisations that can't change quickly, we probably should be looking at. Most organisations aren't changing what they do. I work in a professional services organisation, they plan to be a professional services organisation for a long time. Your insurer plans to be an insurance company for a long time. We probably should be focusing on the things that are going to stay the same, but a long enduring period that continue to deliver what that business is as a unique business. And so that's, you know, it's important for us to think about that. We're here to sustain the business, what it's supposed to be.
Any other relevance? Yeah, no.
Who asked that question?
Is EA relevant to the modern economy?
Well, I think it's alarming that that question's actually being asked. But that shows me maybe a lack of understanding in EA. I was going to offer a one-to-one. So I'll email her directly.
Is Nanda here?
No, she's not. She's not
going
to admit to it.
No, it's so relevant. She's come away.
Well, I've got the list of all participants.
No, well, anyway. It's a good one because it does get to the core of what today has been about. So in that way, it's valuable. Any other thoughts? Yeah, Tom.
There was really just an experience a while back where someone said, several people said that. Now we've got cloud, we don't need now we've got cloud, we don't need enterprise architecture. Right. And I'm just going, you need it much more. The more you outsource, the more separation you have between boundary of identity and boundary of control, the more chaos you're going to create if you haven't got some understanding of what the hell you're doing in your business. The simple way I describe architectures generally, but enterprise architecture in particular, is that it's about things work better when they work together on purpose. Yeah. If you haven't got any idea of what your purpose is, and you haven't got any idea of how things work together, or even if they work, then you're likely to have a problem. So what enterprise architecture is about helping you make sure the stuff actually works together. Well, it's one of our problems, because like an event organizer, the better we do our work, the less visible we become. When we do it badly, we're seen as police. When we do it properly, people say, all he does is talk. And that's the point. Most of what our church work is about, it's about linking people together. So that's a suggestion I have.
Please stop using buzzwords. Cloud.
I'm quoting someone who was quoting at me.
O-double-N-I-S-T.
Okay, anything else on relevance? Otherwise we'll move this to the pile that we've discussed. Good, okay, so the next one is prompted by Tom's keynote. Are requirements really someone else's job? Tom. Or Tom. Which Tom was it?
Okay, contributing to understanding requirements is everybody's job, all the stakeholders. That's literally everybody. So we have a gang of people called business analysts where we really think they're the ones that are supposed to do this, I think. I find them not very enlightened as to how to write clearly good and relevant requirements at all, which is shot. Okay, that's why I was suggesting that the architects, in order to survive, garbage in input had to take over and make sure they got these requirements. So in that sense, the self-interest of the architect is you have to make sure you've got these requirements in, even though you cannot expect them from your resource.
Any other thoughts? Come on, this should be a good one. Yes,
Thank you. Well, just that's something I'm sorry, I'll just talk about in my talk, which is about even requirements can be managed with tension. Not all requirements are equal. Not all requirements are the same. So there are some foundational core requirements that we need to work apart that and elaborate and model very explicitly where we want to see. And there are more transient, more ephemeral, more changeable stuff. So if you just get to potentially manage the requirements and do that, as well as the modeling, which is part of the earlier question about this, but like, the environment is the object of the alternative plan to look at and evaluate. Quite hard to actually evaluate, go and go this way or that way. So we actually get very good in terms of build up for both of them, but we can enable to do much better.
Is requirements not a kind of bit of an IT work? You know, you get a business analyst who say, what are your requirements? And the business guys say, well, what do you mean, what are your requirements? I mean, I don't know what my requirements are. My requirements aren't that clear. I don't know where I'm going or whatever. So, I mean, let's have more debate on this word requirement. Is it the right word? Is that really the dynamic that's going on here? My job.
The requirement is purely a communication medium. It's a contract. And we are very poor at recognising that. They are like, I don't know, the poster, like all the work that's been done before. So you talk about use cases or interviews, you talk about all that. It's just that way of writing down how to make a size of text. Great example of your requirements. And we've got business requirements we create, which we then take and say, okay, now we're going for enterprise architect or solution architect, whatever you want to go create. Each layer of design drives a new one, these levels of requirements. They're just a contract piece, which is why they're an art form, which is why you're talking about clarifying and putting quantitative measures on them. It just makes my skin smile. So many BAs will listen to what the person says. Write down what the person said, and that becomes a requirement. And I think that's it. So they are the contract, and all that smart, good stuff, but they're the contracts that you sign, not the actual lead.
But are they the contract? Is there not a risk of getting a load of users in a room and saying, give me your requirements, and they go out thinking that's what we're going to deliver?
Well, that's what you don't ask for a requirement is. That's what you ask and what they want you to interpret.
That was when I wanted to make one.
Sorry.
The requirement is what the business thinks that they want, an expression of something about what they want. But that isn't necessarily what someone has agreed to give them. The thing that's missing typically in our process, or a lot of company processes, is that someone gathers requirements and there's a negotiation and agreement about what you'll get out of that. That thing is frequently not present. You might have top-level requirements and the next-level requirements, and then the next thing that the process describes is a system that implements all the requirements. Tom's comment and method about categorising cost of requirements and extent of compliance is good, because it tries to put numbers on the cost of achieving some things which may not have been well thought through, and going back with an offer. So the point about contracts, there's a desire, and there should, against that, be an offer. And the offer is what the contract is for delivery. And you might be able, over a series of iterations, to make that a bit more agile by saying, iteration by iteration, we will meet some portion of what it was you said you wanted. And that would be your contract for an iteration.
Okay, yeah. Any thoughts on that? Yes.
I've just heard a sort of a counter view, which is requirements are basically a trap. So lots of business executives don't want to get into talking about requirements because they know that lots of people of professional disciplines, not just EA, are then going to use that as an excuse to stop listening and stop engaging and stop working with business to solve the problem.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I've got one
comment on requirements per se, but I'll give you an example of something I did. In one IT capability I ran for a big business, I stopped what I called honeydews. Honeydew this, honeydew that, honeydew that. I saved 30% of my application development budget. And now nobody missed any of these honeydews. So the kind of the point is that it's like who gets to say on requirements? And if all you're doing is, you know, embellishing all the time, then is that really business value? And I suppose the other point I would make is when we start to get into a real digital business world and we're talking about end-to-end business capability, then surely you make life hard for yourself if requirements are fragmented down to a very low level. You know, and I think a lot of the issues that businesses are facing now when they try and be digital is that, you know, they really want adaptive supply chain, they really want to be able to have a relationship with the end customer, they really want to start doing subscription-based models and data as a product, but they can't because many, many things in their landscape have been so over-customized or over-requirementized, if you like, that suddenly to be able to be digital, they've kind of got to unpick a lot of that. And I suppose one of the things I would say is when is a requirement really your intellectual property or something that makes you so special that maybe it's worth really thinking about? And when does it really stop you from being able to join up with the rest of your business and deliver like a, what I would call a golden thread end-to-end from customer all the way back? And you know, is there a way that we can start to maybe somehow prioritise and segment requirements a lot better so that we, you know, stay true to the strategy?
That sounds great, yeah. Sorry, yeah.
This is just a really quick thought. The way our requirements got better in our organisation is when we were reviewed by testers.
Cracking idea. And tied to the feasibility study where maybe there are some options up front that we're looking at rather than just deciding which way to go. Have we got time for one more question? Yes.
Can I just ask one question?
Yeah, sure.
I'm sitting on my bloody body. Okay. Over requirements. So, I'm an enterprise architect and I agree completely with what you're saying. I spend a huge amount of my time going through trying to sort out what the requirements are. That's not trying to put it into a contract or dot the I's and cross the T's. How can you possibly deliver something if you don't understand what that is? So there's a vast amount of error is programmed right at the front of a system just purely by not understanding what it is. Because when you have a conversation with somebody, you walk out, and that's happened to me several times, where you both agree on what you've just said, and it turns out 2 weeks down the road that you've got completely different views on what you're talking about. So just one question, how many enterprise architects spend a lot of time actually on picking a form line in the form? Just out of curiosity.
Shouldn't your focus be on outcomes?
Yeah.
The requirements are basic things. I think we need to move on from this. Can we move back? We'll have a little chat. It's better outside.
The question was, are the requirements really a job of someone else?
I think you've got to break the requirements into two, functional, non-functional. I think the non-functional stuff definitely goes into the EO unit. Landscape. I think the functional stuff, you started by saying business analysts, but you know, focusing their line of sight on a specific outcome.
Anyway, thank you all for participating in that Q&A. Particularly thank you for Martin, who needs a big round of applause. Not only did Martin come up with the idea, he got it through the committee, he then went and made it happen through the BCS, who were going to buy a site license and then went on holiday. He, through his own initiative, went and bought a license for the conference. So make sure you get on this thing between now and Thursday, because it shuts down. Midnight Thursday. A big thanks to that, because really it's technology in action, which is what we're doing, yeah? So big thank you. Yes?
Can I ask, were all the slides of the
there's two slide decks outstanding which I've requested, but otherwise, if you go into each of the drop downs on the slide tab,
You'll see a preview of the slide. There's a download button. I recommend you do the download on a desktop or laptop, because then you've got something a bit more usable than on the phone.
It'll also be on the BCS website, so it's
And aside to the rest of the committee who've been huddled away in a room somewhere doing normal work, the real brains behind today was Dal, so he also deserves a thank you.
First of all, thank you everyone for coming. I think it's been a good day. The objective of today was to create the first not-for-profit PA conference in the UK. We've done some work throughout the country, and hopefully next year we're going to do bigger and better. Now, on a final note, it's been a long day. The committee would like to offer you drinks outside. There's beer, there's wine, everything you want, just help yourselves. You can't take any of the bottles back, so we expect anyone to finish.